done for me. He has said, when I get home on the other side, I'm mourning, I'm gonna sit down beside my Jesus. I'm gonna sit down and rest a little while. It'll soon be done. When troubles and trials, when I get home, I'm gonna shake my hands with the elders. I'm gonna tell all the people good morning. I'm gonna sit down beside my Jesus. I'm gonna sit down and rest a little while. Amen. Amen.
It is softer.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Amen. We invite you to stand with us.
Wonderful face and the thing and grace.
Gracious, loving, eternal Father, again this evening, Lord, we are so grateful that we can be here another evening to give you thanks and praises. We ask, O Lord, as you gathered here, you would be with us, you continue to protect us. And I pray, Lord, that as the meeting goes on, we may continue to do our part. We will support the evening service and help us, Lord, in whatever we do and say, we'll be faithful and true unto you. We pray this evening again, Lord, that as the preacher prepare himself once more this evening to present your word, I pray that all of us, Lord, that are here will be blessed. And when we leave here, Lord, we'll not be the same. Continue to bless us and keep holy dying.
Of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Good evening, everyone. Hello. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Facebook. Good evening, YouTube. It is my honor and privilege to welcome you into the tonight with us. Do we have any visitors tonight? All right. Okay, so we just want to implore you that even as you listen tonight, this our final week, final night, final Tuesday night, rather, of our series, we pray that you will be richly blessed and that you may open your hearts to receive the blessing of the Lord. We will now tune our voice to our fellowship song.
If you're glad that you're here, please stand.
I'm glad you are here. I'm glad you are here. I want to share my love with you. I'm glad you are here. I'm glad you are here. I want to share my love with you. For we are one. We are one. We are one. We are one. For we are one in the family of God. For we are one, we are one.
For we are one.
Yes, we are one.
For we are one
in the family of God.
I'm glad you are here.
I'm glad you are here. I'm glad you are here. I want to share my love with you. I'm glad you are here. I'm glad you are here. I want to share my love with you. For we are one. We are one.
Oh, we are one.
Yes, we are one.
Oh,
we are one in the family of God.
Oh, we are one.
Yes, we are one.
Oh, we are one.
Oh, we are one.
Oh, we are
one in the family of God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good night, everyone. My name is Jessica Johnson, and I'm from the Seventh-day Adventist Church of Mount Salem. I'm also a digital disciple through SDA Corner. And if you don't know what SDA Corner is, SDA Corner is an online-based Christian community that focuses on sharing and teaching the Word of God. The aim is to grow in Christ daily while encouraging other people to grow with us. So be sure to go on Instagram and follow SDA Corner for encouraging daily content. I have a question to ask you. Can I see a show of hands for anyone here if you've ever felt disconnected from God at any point in time in your life? A show of hands. If you've never felt connected to God. Okay. Whilst it is unfortunate and sometimes saddening, it's also the reason I'm here tonight. It's easy to feel close to God on Saturdays when we're in church or when we've received something that we've asked for. However, strong connections can't only be tended to every once in a while when we feel like it. So the questions in asking are, how do we stay connected to God and how do we maintain this relationship? I'll be sharing 9 ways that we can stay connected to God daily. So the first thing, prayer. Our relationship with God is quite similar to human relationships. They both require communication to grow and develop into something amazing. Through prayer, we can express both our gratitude and worries. So start your day with a prayer. In the middle of your day, pray. When you're about to eat, pray. And right before you go to your bed, pray. This way, you grow your faith and dependence on God in your life. Number 2, read your Bible. If you got a letter or an email from a very close friend overseas, you'd be so excited to read it, and you'd read it. Just as how you would read that letter and stay in touch with that friend is the same way you would read the Bible to stay in touch with God. God has given us the Bible to learn more about Him and to eventually be like Him. Taking time to read His Word helps us to discover who He is and who we are. Number 3, worship God. The Spirit of the Lord resides inside us and we commune with God daily. Scripture says that when we don't know what to pray, the Holy Spirit is at work in us, praying on our behalf. As Christians, we are to acknowledge God's continuous work in and through us. As a response to the work of God in and through our lives, we have to worship Him. So whether it be in your car or on your way to work or while you're in the shower, worship God. It can be through a song or it can be just reflecting on His works. Number 4, involve God in everything. Have you ever helped someone with a project and they took the credit for it and left you high and dry? No credit, none at all. This is the same way God has helped us with even the most minute tasks in our day-to-day lives. We need to acknowledge the fact that God is our rock, serving and into the lives of others around us. Number 7, be grateful. Being grateful helps us to develop our trust in God and teaches us how to be humble. Most times we express gratitude when we have a positive outcome. We have to learn to appreciate the good and the bad. thank God in the easy situations, but you have to thank Him in the difficult situations as well. Thanking Him in the difficult situations can also help us to appreciate the good times even more. Number 8, encourage others. The Christian religion is an advocate for kindness and compassion. Expressing this kindness and compassion through our thoughts and gestures help us to experience closeness to God. A mistake that a lot of Christians make is driving fear into non-believers to get them to start coming to church or reading the Bible. Instead, we should share the benefits of having God in our lives rather than the consequences of not having Him in it. And lastly, spend time in nature. Nature is one of God's greatest creations. Spend time basking in His amazing works. Nature can act as a form of medication for us beings. Our daily lives are cut off from nature with work and school and all the other worldly things. So take some time to free your spirit, take a nature walk, and enjoy the beautiful view. Sometimes it's hard to always be connected to God, especially when we're faced with worldly distractions. But rest assured, follow through with these steps and our connection to God will surely grow. Enjoy the rest of your night.
Amen. And we will definitely work on being connected to God. And at this point in time, we have something to do to show our love, to show our commitment and our faithfulness to God. And that is for us to return an offering unto Him. Luke 6 verse 38 says, "Give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured unto you." The song says we can't beat God's giving no matter how we try. So I implore you at this point in time to take an offering to offer unto the Lord to help with the series, to help with evangelism, so that the message of the gospel can be taken to the old world. Ushers, you will proceed after I pray. Kind Father, we give you thanks for another beautiful day. We thank you for your protection throughout the day that has passed. And as we have come now to give unto you what you have blessed us with, help us to give it with a willing heart. And I pray that you will multiply it so it can do the work that is required. In your name I pray. Amen. Ushers, you may proceed.
What the Lord has done. Good night, everyone. The privilege is mine to introduce the speaker. For the past 4 weeks, he has been presenting the message to us, Elder Michael Henry. And tonight is no exception. But before he come and present the powerful message which the Lord has given to him, we'll know of the Song of Meditation by Brother Bernard. The Never Bernard.
wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know. Worthy is the Lamb.
So like what's right is worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Oh yes he is.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Amen. And the church say amen out down there. We lift our hands and praise the Lord everybody. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Let me say good evening, everybody. Are you happy to be here tonight again? Oh, yes, last night we had rest night. I hope you got some rest. And well, for those who didn't get any rest, that's too bad for you. That's why we gave the night off, to rest, so that we can be here tonight, tomorrow, and Thursday, full 100. Yes, right. Good evening, my YouTube viewers and Facebook. We're happy to have you again. I hope you are hearing me clearly and you're also seeing us. Well, if you're not, just keep on praying that flow will stop acting up so you can be able to see and hear clearly the word of God. Amen. Amen. I want to welcome those who are here for the first time and maybe those online who are joining us for the first time. We're happy to have you. We're happy to have you. Even though you might be here for the first time and it's our last week, our last Tuesday evening, you're still on time to hear a word from the Lord. Amen? Amen. I'm going to miss you when I'm gone, you know. But oh, you're going to miss me too when I'm gone. Amen. And persons who will be able to go home early. Yes. Stand, everybody. Stand, everybody. Let's stand, everybody. We have places to go this evening. Stand with me, everybody. We're going to wave our Bibles again. Make sure you have your Bibles. Make sure you have your Bibles. If you don't have them and you're standing beside somebody with one, just hold on to it. They can't tell you not to hold it. Are you with me? Let's go now. Let's go now. This is my Bible. It is the Word of God. Satan doesn't want me to read and believe this Bible, but I am going to read and believe this Bible, for it is the Word of God. Let's find the Word tonight in the devil's face again. And we sing powerfully now our song, Spirit of the Living God. We are asking as we prepare our hearts and our minds for the word of the living God. Yes, fall afresh on us.
Fall afresh on me.
That's what we're asking him to do. The living God. All afresh. Melt me. Mold me is our prayer this evening. Fill me, fall afresh. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Oh Heavenly Father, this evening again we have gathered here, not in our own strength or power or might, but under the name and strength and power of Jesus Christ. We come again, Lord, to continue our warfare against evil. We come again to lift up Jesus Christ, the risen Savior, who said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Draw some people to you tonight, Jesus. I pray for a double portion of your Holy Ghost power. I pray for a special anointing tonight. I ask you again that you'll kill self in this lump of clay, so I will not be seen or heard but Jesus Christ. Hide me again in the shadow of the cross. Grant me tonight again holy boldness, fearlessness to preach the truth to a lost and dying world. I know the devil is upset with the word tonight before it is even preached, but hold that old rascal in check tonight, Father. Bind him and his forces. May your words go forth with power and clarity and bring deliverance and freedom to your children, and may Jesus be glorified. In his name we pray, and God's people everywhere, we say amen and amen. Thank you, everybody. You may be seated. You may be seated. Let me put this out there. We love Sister Hawkins. I get it right tonight. Praise the Lord. We love people. We love every single person that is alive, because as Christians, we ought to love everybody. But when we preach or when we speak out against certain things, it's not because we are hateful of people, but it's because we hate what they do, and because of the word of God that tells us that what they do is not right, then we have no choice but to speak out against it. But you see, we live in a society where when you speak the truth and you call sin by its right name, worse, the things that people now have no problem with and that society is gravitating to, the intellectuals, the bright minds, the scholars, they have coined the phrase to say that when you speak against what I'm going to talk about tonight, they call it hate crime. But it's not hate crime. It's my hatred against sin. It's the enmity that God has placed in my heart against sin. Let's look at this first text to set the platform. Romans 15 and verse 4. Romans chapter 15 and verse 4. You see, we live in a society where immorality has taken the place of morality. Based on what they do, how they speak, we want to paint the picture that God is a confusing being. Romans 15 verse 4. Hope. Is it clear? So whatsoever we find in the Bible, they are written there for our learning that we do not make the same mistake. Is it clear? I'm just laying the foundation here. Let's go to this book, Genesis chapter 1. You see, if man was holding up the Bible, then the confusion that we have where a man no longer feels comfortable being a man, stay with the preacher, and a woman has lost comfort in being a female, or in their minds they have the confusion that there was this male inside of them all along, and now they are old and the male or the female side is just coming out. Okay, church is quiet. Genesis 1, 26 to 28. Let's go to the beginning. Genesis 1, verse 26 through to 28. What does the word say, preacher man? I want my viewers out there to pay careful attention to the words of God and to listen to me carefully this evening. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through to verse 28. What does the word say, preacher man? And the Bible said, and God said, and who? God said, let us make who? Man. And when that word man, you see it in the Bible, it's not talking about the male gender. It's talking about humanity. So God said, let us make mankind. Let me put that in there. In our image, after our now dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that does what now? Creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and male. Male and something that looks like a female. But the Bible said, God, the Creator, created male and female. Created he them. You ought to say amen with me, church. And then God said to them, be blessed them, and said, be fruitful and replenish it and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, the fowls of the air, over every living thing that moveth upon the air. The earth, it takes a male and a female to multiply. That's what the Bible said. That's how God made them. Am I with you down there? All right, if you don't believe me, because you see, you have intellectual people these days, professors and scholars who think that God is a confused God, and so they are finding it hard to identify who is a male from a female. Because they say that the Bible is not really an inspired book coming from the mind of God, and it was men that wrote the Bible. So in their brightness, because of their intellect, they are finding it hard to accept that the Bible said God made male and female. So let me see if I can help those people tonight, and along with other persons, to understand when God said male, exactly what he's talking about. According to the dictionary, the what? Webster's dictionary, the dictionary of male, God had a conversation with Abraham. You see, Abraham and Lot had parted company, because prior to that they were at one place enjoying the land together. But as people multiply, they had to separate. So Lot, Abram's nephew, took the plains of Sodom, because the grass and the palm trees were pleasant in his eyes. And so he went over there. And as time progressed, God saw the condition of Sodom. And so God came to Abraham and was about to do his thing. And Abraham started to mediate on the people in Sodom's behalf. Why? Because he knew that his nephew was living in those two wicked cities. And so Abraham said, God, if you find 50 down there, tell me, would you destroy the city? And Abraham pleaded with God, would you destroy the city? And God said, Abraham, if I find 10 righteous people living in Sodom, I would spare the city. And the last verse of Genesis 18, the Bible said, God said, shall I hide anything from my servant Abraham? What I am about to do, you ought to know. Somebody ought to hear me tonight. You see, the church that you curse, the church that you badmouth, had it not been for the praying church, your life would be a mess. Had it not been for this church who is interceding and praying for you, your life would be a mess. And Jamaica would be totally destroyed. You're going to say, thank God for the church. For praying men, praying women, praying young people that is praying for you. That's why Jamaica has not been wiped out as yet by God's anger. But one day, hear me, one day very early, mercy will cease to plead. Am I talking to you down here? And so verse 1 of Genesis 19, the angels left Lot and they journeyed down to Sodom. And so the Bible said, now there came two angels to where? To Sodom at evening. And Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. And Lot seeing them, he got up to meet them. And he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And verse 2 said, and he said to them, behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house and tarry all night and wash your feet, and you will get up early and go on your ways. And the angels said a lot, nay, but we will abide in the street all night. Am I talking to you? And verse 3, the Bible said, while they did that in the house of Lot, ladies and gentlemen, something happened. And he said, he encouraged them, and they turned in and entered into his house, and he made them a feast and did bake unleavened bread, and they did eat. You see, that baking of unleavened bread is symbolic. Because unleavened bread, it must be pure. It must have no infirmities or those things in there. The unleavened bread is symbolic of our lives. You don't get the preacher. You see, that what Lot did was a symbolic gesture in showing that he was getting ready to leave where he was. Am I talking to somebody? We need to take those things that are in our lives that will prevent us from making it to glory. Having a good time. Having a good time. Before they lay down, the men of the city. The men of the where? Of the city. Even the men of Sodom and Gomorrah. They compassed the house round, both old and young. Everywhere. Every quarter. While reading this, I was trying to just. They were not pedophiles. They were not murderers. They were not criminals. They were just men going through Sodom on God's business, and Lot, being the gentleman that he is, realizing where they were and knowing his surroundings, invited them to stay in his house until the morning. So why were the men of Sodom so interested to get them out? Well, the next verse tells us why. And the next verse said, they called unto Lot and said to him, where are the men which came into thee this night?
bring them out to us that we may what? Know them. I want you to understand that when they said to Lot, we want to know them, they were not speaking of knowing them on a social basis. You didn't get the preacher. They were not saying to Lot, we want to know them so we can be friends. So we want to know them to see if they want to invest in Sodom and Gomorrah. Am I talking the truth? They had an ulterior motive. You see, in this context, when the Bible said they wanted to know them, in Genesis, the Bible said, and Adam knew his wife, and she brought forth a son, and they called his name Cain. Am I talking to somebody? So the men of Sodom had sexual ambition. Am I talking to you? They had sexual connotations and feelings where it regards to the men in Lot's house.
Lord, you don't believe me? The next verse will tell you. I don't like to use my own words. So Lot went out and he be so wicked. Don't do this wicked thing. Then verse 8, since you don't believe me, verse 8, Lot said to them, tell you what, I have two virgin daughters. You see, Lot knew the men that surrounded his house. He knew the people in Sodom to protect them, to host them for the night. Do not do anything with them. You see, two wrongs don't make a right. So in Lot offering his daughters to them, he was wrong. But Lot was trying to spare the men who came into his house. But what did the men say? When Lot said, take my daughters, the next verse tells us, but the men reached out their hands, but verse 9 said, and they said, stand back, and they said, this one fellow, you come into a place, our homeland, and you want to dictate to us what we do, who we sleep with, and all those things. Are you hearing me down here? And so they tried to break down the door. This thing's not sounding good. Come on, tech man. So, you see, the previous verse, when Lot tried to give them his daughters, the men of Sodom have no interest in your daughters. Let me say it again. We have no interest in your daughters. We want the men. Sodom bound is the world tonight. Sodom bound is Jamaica. We men have no interest in women, and women have no interest in men. All right. So when they said, okay, since you don't want us to have those men, we are going to take you then. Read the rest when you go home. So they rushed up on Lot. And the Bible said the men in the house pulled him in and shut the door. And then they smote the men on the outside with blindness. But you see, there's something I don't want to miss in these verses. You see, the Bible said men from every quarter in Sodom and Gomorrah, men from the east, men from the west, men from the north and the south. And the Bible also made it very clear that young men, old men, every single age group was there, because every single age group was involved in this kind of lifestyle. And that's why tonight the same condition exists in our world. Am I talking the truth down here? Young men are involved, old men are involved, young ladies, old women, everybody is caught up in the sodomist lifestyle.
We are sad and bound as a world. We are sad and bound as a country. And that's why tonight again I am here to say to God's people, you need to escape for your life.
And so the men said to Lot, tell me something. Tell me something, Lot. Do you have anyone else here in this place except you? And Lot said, I have my son-in-laws. And the men said, get them. And Lot went and he preached to his son-in-laws. He told them what the angels of God told them. Am I talking down here? Because the men were angels. They were on a mission of destruction. And the people of Sodom had no idea. Am I talking to you? Their last night of reverie was there. Their last night of fun and pleasure. They were enjoying, not knowing that destruction was hanging over their head. Not knowing that that night would be their last night. I stopped by to tell somebody on YouTube, to tell this world, to tell America, to tell Canada, to tell England, to tell Jamaica, that destruction is hanging over this world's head and people have no idea. To them, it's business as usual. So the Bible said they laughed at him. And they mocked him like what many people are doing tonight. Am I talking to you down here? Many people are mocking us tonight. Many people are laughing at me this evening. And can I tell somebody? Many people will still not be moved to surrender their lives to God. But whether you want to believe it, yes or no, you must be told that Earth's last night is steaming by. So the men said, Lot, tomorrow destruction is coming. You need to get out of here. Am I talking to you down here? They said, Lot, you need to escape for your life. The Bible said while the men tried to get Lot to leave Sodom, Lot was lingering. Lot was delaying. You see, because maybe if it was in our time, he would have some Prados, some Lexus, some BMWs. Maybe he'd be living in an upscale community and he would find it hard to leave. Just like our many people tonight, they are finding it hard to leave the world and come to Jesus. They're finding it hard to leave the party, to leave the pleasure, to lead the gambling house, to lead the rum bar, to lead the kind of lifestyle that will take them to hell. They find it hard because people love pleasure more than God. But the Bible said while he lingered, the angels grabbed a hold of him and pulled him out of Sodom. You see, God is going to have to lay his hands on some people literally in order to save them. Am I talking to somebody? You see, God, hear me, somebody. You see, God is going to have to burn down some big mansions. You didn't get the preacher. God gonna allow your cars to be stolen, your cars to be write off. God will allow you to feel sickness so you can lay flat on your back, and all your friends will forsake you. All your money won't be able to help you, just to save you. God will do anything to save you. That's why sometimes people say don't force nobody to get baptized. Sometimes it's not forcing, it's helping people to change their lives, to run from death into life. If the angels are taking our stand, you know, sometimes we say we're not forcing anybody. So we talk to them one time and that's it. If the angels had left Lot to linger,
and to wonder, Lot would be a dead man in Sodom. Are you hearing me down here? So in our world tonight, we have people, Ella Dockery, men who, when you look at them, Sister Hutchinson, you can't really recognize if it's a man or a woman. Talk to me, church. I went to a certain place just last week. And while I was in that certain place, I saw a certain individual walking like this. Walking like this. And the head shaved bald around the side. And I looked and I was confused. I was baffled. So I looked, and I could not tell. So I asked someone in the store that I was standing beside. It's a good thing I've had my mask, you know. So they couldn't tell I was asking question. So I said to the person, tell me something. Is that individual a male or a female? And the person said to me, that's a female. I said, you're lying. You didn't get the preacher. Her chest was as flat as mine. Her walk had more bounce than my walk. And I consider myself to walk properly, to walk with some bounce. I didn't get the preacher. But I couldn't stand in her shoe. You see, two pot covers can't lock Ella Dockery. Talk to me, church. Two pot covers can't go together. You have to have a pot and a cover. And you can't have two swords going together. For every sword, you have a shield. Am I talking to you? And that's why God made Adam and Eve. So, all right. But in our world, you have men who have taken on themselves to want to be women. Talk to me in a church, man. Yes, man, talk to me. Let the people on YouTube know I'm not alone down here. So if they come for me, they come for you too. So we have men who want to be women because they are no longer comfortable being a man. And we have women who want to be men because they are no longer comfortable being a female. And we have lawmakers, intellectual people, who wants to change God's order to suit this kind of lifestyle. You're not with the preacher. And so they craft up legislations, they craft up these laws to justify a man and a man marrying. Can't work. God did not design for two men to come together. God did not design for two females to come together. And you have some nasty pastors who stand in a church, however they stand, and look at two bushy-faced men, crafty men, and then want to declare them husband and husband. Can't have husband and wife with two men and joining two feet and using the name of God. God gonna fix this world. Just like what he did to Sodom, God gonna burn this world up. All right. In 2000, the Netherlands was the first country to pass same-sex marriage. Huh? You know what that mean? Two bushy-faced men can get married and go to bed. Nastiness.
Okay, you don't say amen tonight.
The country became the first in the world to legalize this kind of nastiness. In 2003, Belgium followed. In 2005, Canada followed. In 2005 also, Spain and South Africa. In 2006, are you hearing me down there?
And hear what this man said in 2013. The Deputy Prime Minister of UK, Nick Clegg, he says that no matter who you are and who you love, we are equal. Lie!
Equal as human beings in God's sight. But two men can't be married and you're equal in God's sight. God said it's an abomination.
And in 2020, Costa Rica joined the rest and legalized same-sex marriage. Eh? And in 2021, Switzerland followed. And according to CBS in America, just a few days ago, the House of Representatives, they passed the same-sex marriage bill.
And if America catches a cold, Jamaica sneeze.
Or is the other way around? If America sneezes, Jamaica catch the cold.
So from its pass over there, before you know it out here, you're going to have our people thinking about doing it.
And in Jamaica, you have something called J-Flag. I am going hard, you know, if you don't like it. You see what I've just read? What I just gave you about those countries? You can find those information there in Good Morning America. That's where you can find them. Are you hearing me down here? In Jamaica here, you have something called J-Flag. Am I talking the truth? They said this group started by a group of 12 men and women. Here are the people that make up this community. J-Flag. You know what J-Flag means? You know what it means? All right, I don't want to know. Here are the people that makes up this organization. Educators, lawyers, public relations practitioners, advertisers, and human rights activists who saw the need to advocate for the protection of LGBT people from state-sanctioned and community violence. I am not telling you to kill nobody, but we must speak out against sin. And for two men to come together, that's sin. It doesn't matter in which country. It doesn't matter how much money they have. Sin is sin. And as long as God lends me breath, I'm going to call homosexuality by its right name, sin. And if I'm the only preacher in my circle that's going to call it by its name, I don't care. As a matter of fact, I don't have to go to America. You didn't get the preacher. I don't have to go there. So when they go on YouTube and find the sermon and blacklist me, that's good. My home is in glory. I don't need a visa to get to heaven. All I need is a relationship with my Jesus. And that's why tonight I'm saying to the world, repent. Judgment is coming.
Hear what J-Flag said.
My time.
Hear what J-Flag said. J-Flag call was for the fair and equal treatment of gays and lesbians under the law and by the ordinary citizen. What kind of treatment do they want? The only treatment I have for them is Jesus. Don't tell me that's how you were born. Lie! It's a choice you make. Don't tell me it was in your genes either. If you have that kind of genes, get rid of it. Am I talking to you down here? Don't tell me you can't change. You can. You can. You can. Jesus can help you. Jesus can change your lifestyle. Hear what is JFLAG's mission. I can't speak to America. They are doing their thing. If I get over there, I'll preach to them like this. But hear what JFLAG said, Elder Bernard. Their mission, Sister Hawkins, is to promote social change by empowering Christian principles. Do you know that our anthem is a prayer? Our song is a prayer? Our Jamaica, if you should remove God, my vision, more role of a male. When I was working at LADOC, my co-workers used to trouble me because they were having their children. Now some have two with all, four or five with enough woman. And they say, anyway, you're not getting any. I say, I'm good, man. I'm still good. And you know what they call me? You have some guinea tree, elder? Elder that we don't know. You have some guinea tree that don't bear. What they call them? Man guinea, eh? Because I can't. But the guinea that bears the fruit, they don't call a tree man guinea. That's a female guinea tree. Talk to me. Am I right? You know, everything God made, he made male and female. Eh? So why is it that man refuses to accept how God made them? Don't you see the devil at work? And you know what else is destroying the world? Leviticus 19:29. God said to the mothers, do not prostitute your daughters. Because in doing so, the nation is going to be full with blood. You know why Jamaica is so bloody? Because parents are giving their children over to prostitution. Because parents have become greedy. They're not what they preach at all. Mothers can't satisfy, so they have their innocent daughters and they give them over to these big old grown thirsty men because they want money. But God said, when you do that, you're calling down blood. That's why the land is so wicked. Let me read these few texts in the next 5 minutes for you. Romans 1 verse 18 to 28. What does the word say, preacher? And I must tell you, Romans 1 verse 18 through to verse 28. Tell me somebody. For the wrath of God is what now? Revealed from where? Heaven against what, church? All ungodliness and unrighteousness of what? For why? Because that when they knew God, when they what? When they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but because vain in their imaginations and their foolish heart was darkened. What did they do, Paul? Talk to the nation, Paul. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. The next verse said, Paul, talk to me, Paul. Why are they fools? Why are these so-called professors and intellectuals and sociologists and all these bright-minded people? Why are they fool preacher man? Because they change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things because they are trying to change who God is. Therefore, God said, I'm going to give them up to uncleanness. They forsake God. So God said, I'm going to give them over to uncleanness, to the lust of their own hearts. Am I talking to you? To dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Why preach a man? For they change the truth of God into a lie. It's a lie that says two men can get married. It's a lie that says two women can get married. It's a lie. God says male and female. But they change the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the creator who is blessed forever. Come on, say amen down here. And the next verse said quickly now, for this cause God gave them up unto the affections, vile affections, for even their woman. Change the natural use one toward another. Men with men. Working that which is unseemly and reserving in themselves that recompense of their error which was good. God gonna fix it one day. Men have turned away from God. Men have closed the Bible and opened their minds to Satan. Men have turned their backs on God and is worshiping Satan. That's why the world is the way it is. That's why we are Sodom bound. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Am I talking to you down here? And that's why 2 Peter verse 2 and verse 6, the Bible said, 2 Peter 2 and verse 6, the Bible said, and turning the cities of where? Sodom and Gomorrah into what now? Ashes. Condemn them with an overflowing, making them an example unto America, unto Canada, unto UK, unto Netherlands, unto Jamaica, making them an example. You ought to hear me tonight. Whatsoever things were written aforetime, that was my first text. Am I talking to you? It's written for our learning, that through patience of the scripture we might have hope. Come on, say amen, somebody. 2 Peter 3, verse 5 to 7 and 9 and 10, the Bible said, for this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God, the heavens that were of the old, and the earth standing out of the water, and in the water. And the Bible said, that they that were by then, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water, that world perish. Am I talking to somebody? But not water this time, but the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved Glen Devon, reserved Norwood, reserved St. James, unto fire. You don't hear the preacher. Fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. It's gonna rain one day. No more water, but fire. This time it's gonna rain. Verse 9 said, what does verse 9 say, preacher man? The Lord is not what? Slack concerning who? His promises, as some men do what? But his long suffering to us ward, not what? Willing that any should what? Perish. But that all should do what? Come to what now? Come to what, church? Repentance. But the day of the Lord, somebody ought to hear me, will come as a thief when you least expect it, in the night in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. You ought to know that Sodom and Gomorrah was burnt to the ground by the fires of Almighty God because of the sodomistic lifestyle and the homosexual behavior and their oppression and their injustice and their crime and their murder. God, rain down fire. And this world tonight, as we know it, is poised for the fires of God because the same thing that took place in Sodom, the same thing is happening all around us. But I'm so glad tonight that one day, very early, God gonna say, enough is enough, and fire gonna come. Sinners gonna be burned. Hear me, homosexuals. Hear me, lesbians. Hear me, murderers. Hear me, gunmen. Hear me, scammers. The Bible said God is not willing that any should perish, but you come to repentance. He's saying, come tonight. Like Lot, he's saying, escape for your life. Like Lot, he's saying, escape for your life. But many of you are laughing. Laugh all you want. He who laugh last gonna laugh best one day. Laugh at me tonight. But I'm still saying, God is saying, come. Come away from that kind of lifestyle. Come away from those sinful habits. Come, I can help you. God can help you. Well, the choice is yours. Isaiah 1:17-20, I'm done tonight. We are Sodom bound, beloved. Whether you believe it, yes or no. And can I tell you, if we're not careful, it's going to find its way in the church. You didn't hear me down here? If you're not careful, Glen Devon, it's going to find its way in the church. You're going to have men up here who have their man in the congregation and you can't say anything. But God forbid, if I am the only one that will stand in Chester Castle and said, not so, I'm going to stand up. Stand up. It's coming because these people have money. They have clout. They have power. They have influence. And if you don't go along with them, they can do what they want with you. And they have the backing of the courts. Are you seeing what I'm saying, church? You know how many people in America and other parts of the world have lost their job because they refuse to go along with this nastiness? But hear what God says tonight. He said in Isaiah 17:20, I'm done tonight. He's saying, learn to do well. Seek judgment, huh? Relief the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Are you hearing me down here? Then God said, come now. You hear God calling you, my homosexual friend? You see, you have some people tonight, if they know that you are homosexual, they don't want you to come near them. Your families might not even want to talk to you. Your friends might not even want to associate with you. But hear the loving God. He's saying, come now. Come now. Let us reason together. I know your lifestyle. I know your struggles. You want to be free. I can help you. You see, you don't have anyone to talk to because they don't want to talk to you. They don't want to be seen with you. But he's saying, come now. Come talk to me. Let us reason together. I am a reasonable God. Come on, say amen, somebody. Come, let us reason together, say the Lord. Though your sins be as what? They shall be as what? Though they be red like? they shall be as well. What God is saying, my friend, is I can fix it for you. I can change you. I can give you new feelings, new desire, new mindset, new passion. I can change your heart. But come now, let's reason together. He said, if you are willing, are you willing? If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat of the good of the land. Are you willing? Are you willing to come for Jesus to change you? Are you willing to come for his grace? When he said the good of the land, it's not necessarily the good of this land down here, but the good of the land he has gone to prepare for you. How willing are you to obey the words of God that you were not born that way? It's a choice, a wrong choice. But he said if you're willing and obedient, you will eat of the good of the land. But if you refuse, if you refuse and you rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Not Michael Henry, but God. Come on and say amen down here, somebody. Tonight, God is calling his children. You see, my gay friends, my folks out there who are that kind of lifestyle, God loves you. He loves you, but he hates your sin. Are you hearing me out there? He loves you, but he hates what? And so he wants to change you before he destroys you. And so he's calling you tonight. Stand, everybody. He's calling you tonight. It's the last Tuesday evening down here. Look at the world tonight. In our textbook, they are creating textbook in that fashion to promote this kind of lifestyle. So very shortly, our children are going to be so confused. Our young people are already confused. But tonight God has helped to clear the confusion. It's not God's ideal. God made no man or woman that way. They choose that kind of lifestyle because they turn their backs on the true God. And so God gave them to their reprobate minds where they believe that's the right way to go. But fire is coming to cleanse this earth, to purify this place, to rid all. But I'm so glad tonight that before that happens, a warning is given. A warning is given to every man. And tonight you can escape in the arms of Jesus. You can escape and hide in the blessed rock of ages. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed tonight. You're out there as we pray. Utilize the link in the chat. Utilize the numbers you see on your screen. Get in touch with those individuals. If you're willing and you want God to change, I know you're struggling. I know you want to be changed. I know you are struggling. Oftentimes, I believe tears roll down your face like a fountain because you realize the life you're living is not the life that God wants you to live and get. I can bring you back into safety. I can resuscitate you. I can sustain you. God is calling you, my friends, tonight online. Wherever you are in Jamaica, wherever you are in the world, and you'll view this sermon afterwards, God is a loving God. And the message tonight is not to condemn anybody. It's just to highlight the sinful place we are living in called earth. It's just to highlight the immorality of society, what we're embracing as a people, and to show you God's ideal and God's disdain for the abomination that is taking place on the land.
is to help you to know that there's a better way. You declare that the Lord be merciful. It was in your divine mercy that you rescued Lot from Sodom. But in Sodom, you couldn't even find 10. And so those two cities, with all their luxury, with all their fine buildings, with all the precious enjoyments that they were accustomed to, finally, judgment rained down on that morning. Unexpectedly, as they continued their business, came down God. By calling that young lady, you're calling that gentleman, you're calling that woman, you're calling that boy, you're calling that girl. God, you're calling your people because you know that judgment is coming. Pluck somebody tonight, God, from the hands of the enemy. Hold on to somebody tonight. Pull them if you must, Jesus. Pull them from certain destruction. Pull them like how you pulled Lot out of Sodom. Pull them tonight out of destruction. Because as we know it, the world is Sodom bound. And he even spoke of that the coming of Jesus is near. When we see in the halls of government, bills are passed to promote same-sex marriages. Bills are passed to promote men and men. Deliver somebody tonight. And before it's too late, deliver somebody. And help us as a church to stand on your words, to never back down, to never be afraid, to speak the plain, thus saith the Lord. And help us to hold on to you and pull us to safety as well. So when the fire is safe in that city with you, our Lord. Thank you for tonight, to hear from you the last Wednesday evening in this program is our prayer. In Christ's name, and we say, amen. Thank you, everybody. Those online, we God, we bless you this evening. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Until then, the Lord bless you and keep you.
Thank you so much, everyone. We just want to remind you, even as we expect to see you turning out tomorrow evening at 7, that tomorrow the special feature will be a very special prayer session, right? So whatever your struggles, your issues, whatever your desires, requests are, please feel free to write, to submit them early, even via the chat. Submit your prayer requests. And tomorrow evening at prayer power session, we will place all your requests before the Lord. God bless you. Do have a safe journey home. Even until we meet again tomorrow evening in your numbers. Yes, at 7 p.m.